Power supply design can be some pretty confusing business. You've got surge protection to make sure no bad stuff gets in, EMI protection to make sure no bad stuff gets out, transformers and rectifiers to tame all that crazy AC stuff that's left, you know, to iron out all the wrinkles, and finally, regulation to get the DC you actually wanted in the first place. Phew! And of course, for each of those stages, there's about a bazillion parts to choose from. You've got filters and chokes and transformers and capacitors and inductors and deductors. Well, no, deductors is not a thing. I made that one up. Hi, I'm Amelia Dalton, host of Chalk Talk. I could really use some guidance on power supply design and component selection, and I bet you could too. My guest today is Nick Stephen from KEMET, and we're going to go deep on the latest in power supplies. And before we get started, don't forget to click that link. There you can find even more information about this topic. Hi, Nick. Thank you so much for joining me.
Hi, Amelia. Thank you for having me.
Okay, so we are here to talk about power supplies. So let's start with the basics.
So power is the foundation of any electronic system, and the power supply is what feeds the system. When it comes to choosing a power supply, you got to be really, really careful with it. A proper power supply is essential to make sure that your device is working at optimum levels. A power supply is any device that supplies energy or power to an electrical circuit. For example, fuel is power supply for a car, and batteries can be power supplies for your TV remote. There are three different types of power supplies. First, we have the standalone units, like the bricks we plug into wall for laptops or cell phones. Then we have built-in units, like in refrigerators or other home appliances. And finally, we have hybrid units. They are built-in, like the ones in your laptops or cell phones. Each one of your devices need a different amount of power or direct current to function. The main task of a power supply is to regulate the voltage so your device is operating properly.
So Nick, where exactly does the power or electricity come from?
To make this easier, let's talk about the electrical grid. The electrical grid is the network through which the power is generated, transmitted, and distributed to the consumers. The electrical grid has four different components. First, we have the generating plants. Then we have transmission lines, substations, and distribution lines. After this electricity is generated, the voltage is stepped down at a substation, allowing the electricity to be transported over long distances. AC current, or alternating current, is better than direct current for transmission because it minimizes power loss. You're trying to lose as little power as possible in your transmission lines. The stepped-up electricity is then transported to different destinations with the help of transmission lines. Here, transmission lines can either be overhead or underground. Once it reaches the destination, another substation steps down the voltage to a level suitable for distribution lines. At this point, this is where we need our power supply. Most of our homes are considered a secondary customer. Our homes have several electronic devices such as refrigerators, computers, appliances, TV, and the power requirements may vary depending on the device you're trying to power. This is where a power supply is essential.
Okay, so what happens once the power reaches your home?
The final stage of power delivery is done by power supply where DC power is needed. The overall architecture of a power supply design involves surge protection stage and EMI filter stage. During the surge protection stage, the main focus is to lower the impact of the transient overvoltage. At the EMI filter stage, this takes care of all the unwanted emissions that are escaping your design. The main objective here is to meet safety regulations and other agency certifications. Then we move on to the transformer and rectification stage. This stage transforms the AC signal into unregulated DC power. And finally, we have smoothing and regulation. The smoothing section takes care of making the output of the transformer stable. This means it will be charging and discharging based on the load. And regulation, which is probably the most important section, at this stage, your voltage is regulated to appropriate values depending on your load. There are two different types of regulators. We have the linear regulator and a switching regulator. It's very important to keep a good relationship between the output capacitor and inductor size at this point.
All right, Nick, that circuit looks crazy. Can we break this down and make it simpler?
Absolutely. To make it easier for you and everyone else, let's break down the main sections of a power supply and talk about the details. The first stage of a power supply is surge protection and AC line filtering. There are several different components that go into this, but the main one here I want to focus on is the AC line filter. For AC line filters, we have differential mode and common mode filters. In addition to the filters, you can also use our resistors for transient protection and safety capacitors.
Okay, cool. Now tell me about those AC line filters.
For our AC line filters, we have several different ones. We have more than 1,000 parts and more than 60 series. Instead of bragging about these numbers, the story I want to tell today is what makes us different. The ferrite material we use for our product is unique to us. We develop it and we produce it. Depending on the application, we can modify the material however we want. The trend back in the day used to be who has the highest permeability material on the market.
So what is permeability?
Permeability is the parameter that shows how much electromagnetic waves a substance can absorb. Think of it as a sponge absorbing water. The higher the magnetic permeability, the better the material allows for magnetic flux to pass through it. The new trend will be products in the high temperature market. KEMET having a lot of focus in the automotive sector, we need to be able to support these higher temperature demands. We currently have 5HT material that can support up to 225 degrees Celsius, and we have better products that are being developed right now.
Can you give me some details on these filters?
Sure, let's get into that. There are two different types of filters. We have differential mode, and these are two of the most popular series. Then we also have common mode. These are some of the important series in common mode filters. A lot of engineers are familiar with common mode and differential mode filters, but not a lot of people know about our dual mode. As we discussed, the EMI filter stage uses at least three different chokes to filter differential and common mode. What if I told you we can take all three of those coils and make it into one? That's exactly what our dual mode coils do. The most important feature here is space saving. Earlier, we had three filters in the circuit. With the dual mode, we can reduce that down to one. This is critical for some applications because all that extra space can be used for other components or to miniaturize your application.
All right, so what else do you have for the AC filtering stage?
Class X and Class Y capacitors are safety certified and used in AC line filtering in many electronic device applications. Class X is a design used across the line, and they are rated based on the peak voltage pulse as shown in the table. Class Y is also known as line-to-ground capacitor. These capacitors have higher rating when compared to X capacitors.
Where are these capacitors used?
X2 and Y2 capacitors are most commonly used in appliances that plug into all sockets. And X1 and Y1 are commonly used in industrial settings where the circuit is not removed from the power outlet. It's important to note that Class Y can be used in place of Class X, but not the other way around.
Okay, so what happens after this?
After the filtering stage, the signal goes through transformer and rectification stage where the AC is converted into unregulated DC. The unregulated DC must go through regulation stage to make it suitable for your application.
Okay, cool. Can we talk about the DC side?
There are two different types of regulators, a linear regulator and a switching regulator. A linear regulator is a system used to maintain steady voltage. The resistance of the regulator varies according to the load, resulting in a constant voltage output. All linear regulators require an input voltage higher than the desired output voltage. That minimum amount is called the dropout voltage. A low dropout or LDO regulator is a DC linear regulator which can regulate the output voltage even when the supply voltage is very close to the output voltage. Linear regulators are a great way of powering devices that require ultra-stable voltage rails, such as processors or other applications where the difference between the input voltage and output voltage is very small. They're a very simple and cheap solution, but linear regulators are normally inefficient because the difference between the input and regulated output is continually dissipated as heat.
What about the switching regulator?
A switching regulator is a voltage regulator that uses a switching element to transform the incoming power supply into pulse voltage, which is then smoothed using capacitors, inductors, and other elements. Power is supplied from the input to the output by turning on a switch, in this case it will be a MOSFET, until the desired voltage is reached. Once the output voltage reaches the predetermined value, the switch element is turned off and no input power is consumed. Repeating this operation at high speeds make it possible to supply voltage efficiently and with less heat generation. There are mainly two different types of switching regulators, a boost regulator and a buck regulator. Boost regulator's output will be higher than its input, and the buck regulator is the opposite. They generate a lower voltage from its input. Given the nature and architecture of a switching regulator, you will always have a ripple voltage. First, you need to understand the voltage ripple requirements and the limits of your applications.
Okay, Nick, tell me more about that ripple voltage and current.
The basic relationship of inductance, voltage, and change in current is the starting point for any switching regulator. A change in current will develop a large voltage across the inductor, as shown by the equation. The output of a switching regulator is basically an LC filter. The inductor is used to store and release energy during the switching phase, and the capacitor is used to smooth out the voltage. In a switching regulator, the current in the inductor has a triangular waveform, and as current goes up, it's charging the input capacitor. During the next phase, the capacitor is the main source of power. The current charging and discharging generates ripple voltage based on the ESR and ESL of the capacitor, and along with the switching frequency of the devices. The typical switching frequency for these regulators is between 30 kHz and 1 MHz. The most common switching frequency range is from 300 to 500 kHz, and as the switching frequency increases, the inductor size is reduced. The choice of inductance controls the ripple current. Smaller ripple current means smaller ripple voltage. This relationship makes the choice of your inductor size crucial.
Cool. Can you tell me more about picking out an inductor?
Let's take a look at an example of a buck converter switching regulator. These are the given requirements for an automotive application. In a buck regulator, the output voltage is expected to be lower than the input voltage. A switch allows current to flow into the output. The inductor that is used constrains the current, causing it to ramp up. And it's during the ramping up the capacitor gets charged. Then, when the switch is turned off, naturally the current wants to stop flowing, but the inductor will use its stored energy to keep the current flowing. During the off phase, the power will be sourced by the output capacitor. Before the energy is depleted from the inductor, the switch is turned back on, and it repeats the cycle all over again. As you notice, the current on the inductor has a triangular waveform. This change is represented as DI. The average of the waveform is your design output current. RCR, which is the ratio of DI to the output current, is an important parameter to keep in mind. And this number should always be kept within 0.25 and 0.4. Now that we understand all the concepts, let's do some math. This is the inductance equation for a buck regulator. When plugging in all the given parameters, we get an inductance value of 40.44 microhenry. Once you have your inductance value, you can go over to mouser.com and pull up our datasheet for METCOM MPX series. From the datasheet, you can pick out this part number with an inductance value of 47 microhenry.
So, Nick, why did you decide to pick a 47 instead of a lower number?
So, notice the saturation current all the way to the right of that part number is 2.5. This saturation current is over our 1 amp requirement. Saturation current is defined as 20% decrease in inductance value at a rated current. Take a look at the graph to ensure that at your output current of 1 amp, the inductance is above the 40 microhenry that we calculated, which is why we picked a 47 microhenry part.
So what exactly is METCOM?
METCOM stands for metal composite, and this is the material that we use for our power inductors. METCOM power inductors are ideal for DC to DC switching power supplies, as well as EMI filter inductors. Our metal composite core has a high saturation characteristic, ideal for designs requiring stable inductance across temperature and current. The operating temperature of METCOM ranges from negative 55 degrees Celsius up to 155 degrees Celsius, and the rated inductance goes up to 47 microhenry.
Now that we have our inductor, what do we do next?
The next step after this is to pick your input capacitor and output capacitor to meet the requirements. From our DI equation earlier, we're already assuming that our ESR is 120 milliohms. Here, you can use different capacitor technologies to accommodate to your design requirements. On a switching regulator output, different capacitor technologies will change the amount of ripple voltage based on the ESR and ESL as shown in the graph. Having multiple capacitors in parallel will improve the combined impedance effect over frequency. It's usually a design requirement to maintain a certain impedance level over a particular frequency band to ensure that we can cover all the required transients. The graph shown is from our capacitor simulation tool, KSIM. This plot shows the combined impedance of one 0201 capacitor, two 0402s, two 0603s, and a KOCAP capacitor. The network of capacitors maintains an impedance below 100 milliohms from about 100 kHz up to 70 MHz. From here, you can examine the effect of combined impedance and ESR across frequency.
So what else do we need to be thinking about when selecting filtering capacitors?
When selecting an MLCC in particular, Class 2 and Class 3 dielectrics like X7R and X5R, you have to look into DC bias and aging factor. On the other hand, Class 1 such as C0G and U2J, or higher density technology like KEMET's KOCAP, you do not have to worry about DC bias and aging. For MLCCs, aging is not a property of capacitor reliability and is not related to the overall lifetime of the application. Aging is simply a phenomenon where the capacitance changes over time and is an important factor that designers need to consider when using ceramic capacitors. Aging occurs in all Class 2 and Class 3 dielectric capacitors from any manufacturer and is related to the material properties of the dielectric. Let's take a look at an example of a 10 microfarad X7R capacitor. After the PCB reflow process is finished, the part starts to cool down and the aging process timer begins. The capacitance starts to decrease around 3% per decade hour. Another important factor to consider is DC bias. When a DC voltage is applied to Class 2 and Class 3 MLCCs like X7R, they lose capacitance based on this bias voltage. Here you can use KEMET's KSIM to estimate the DC bias effect for a given KEMET MLCC.
So what about KOCAPs?
So along with the MLCC, and in order to avoid aging and DC bias, a designer must consider to use our polymer capacitors, or KOCAPs. A typical construction detail of KOCAP is shown. Tantalum polymer capacitors have a tantalum pentoxide dielectric with a polymer cathode. This polymer material can actually consume oxygen and makes it non-conductive. This is what differentiates a polymer capacitor from our traditional tantalum capacitors. Since most applications do require long-term reliability, KEMET recommends that designers consider a voltage derating according to the graphic above for maximum steady voltage. The biggest advantage of our KOCAP technology is the ability to pack a lot of capacitance in small package. While the ESR might not be as low as MLCC, it still has a very low ESR. KOCAPs are mostly used in under 1 megahertz frequency range without self-resonance effects.
This all sounds great. Now, Nick, where would I go for more information?
You can go over to mouser.com/KEMET and check out our new landing page for all the information related to these products. If you're interested in METCOM, please go to KEMET.com/METCOM. If you want to check out our aging calculator, you can find that under ec.kemet.com. And like always, KSIM can be found under ksim.kemet.com.
Excellent. I think that's all I have time for today. Thank you so much for joining me yet again, Nick.
Thank you, Amelia.
And before we go, you didn't forget to click that link, did you? There you can find even more information about this topic from KEMET and Mouser Electronics. For Chalk Talks, I'm Amelia Dalton from eejournal.com. For more Chalk Talks, head on over to the Chalk Talk section of EE Journal. You can't miss it. It's right across the top. Or check out YouTube, keyword EE Journal.